Welcome to the Fallen State. I'm Jesse Lee Peterson. A lot of men want a relationship, but it's difficult approaching women. I have with me matchmaker and love and relationship coach, DeAnna Lorraine. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
How did you become a matchmaker / relationship coach?
My parents got divorced when I was 9 years old, and it was a really hard divorce. And then my mom remarried. 10 years later, they went through another divorce. And so it, for me, growing up with that, and I was starting to see the demise of relationships all around me. Kids at my school, their parents were getting divorced. It just started becoming more mainstream. And I realized that this is something that, wow, I mean, I want to help change no matter what. You know, I want to see how I can prevent divorce, how I can make a dent in creating healthier, better, loving relationships with people, and in having people choose the right partner to begin with so they don't have a relationship where it's faced with divorce.
You're not married, right?
I'm not married.
Have you ever been married?
No, I have
you
not.
You want to be married?
Yes, of course.
You do? You want to get married?
Yes, I do.
And what type
of... I still believe in marriage, yeah.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
What type of man are you looking for, you would like to have?
Are you matchmaking me? I'm looking for a man who's a match for me. You know, he's someone who's intelligent and ambitious and someone who's deep. I'm looking for someone who's also spiritual and shares my values around spirituality. For me, I'm more of a traditionalist, and it's hard to find men these days and women who value more traditional values.
And so do you mostly advise men or women, or is it equal?
Oh, yeah, okay. It's about equal. Although it's about a 60-40% split, a little bit more men than women.
What do men tell you that they are looking for in a relationship? What exactly do they want?
Well, most men want a relationship with, of course, physical attraction is important. And for men, because men are attracted visually first and foremost, you know, I mean, and women are attracted by different things, but for men, it's visual first and foremost. That's important. So I can't undermine that. Women need to, you know, look a certain way and be presentable and show that there's beauty and vitality there for a man to be attracted.
Yeah.
But beyond that, what I'm saying actually now is interesting. The tide's changed a little bit. Before, there was a book called Why Men Love Bitches. I'm sure you remember that book. It was really popular.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was all about giving men the chase and the challenge and being bitchy and everything. Now the tide's changed a little bit, and men are actually so tired of bitches.
Yes.
they want to be attracted, of course. Secondly, they're like, can you just find me like a nice girl who's not bitchy, who is not so entitled and who doesn't act so, you know, demeaning. Like, you know, a lot of guys don't want this super feminist kind of woman.
Right.
So niceness is actually, it's falling in number two. And then someone who is a good conversationalist and someone who can be supportive of him.
What's a good conversation for a man with a woman?
You know, a conversation that has some level of depth to it. And, you know, you can talk about current events without her not knowing anything that's going on in the world.
Yeah.
And also conversations that don't end in this kind of combative one-upmanship that a lot of women like to seem to present these days with men. A man just wants to feel, at the end of the day, a lot of times supported and, you know, and empowered and have conversations that are inspiring and that leave feeling good rather than leave feeling like, you know, they're competing with someone.
What happened to women, and not all, but most, I'll say age 55 and down, they seem to be empty and shallow and...
I don't know why I laughed with that, but it's true.
And
it's a laughter recognition.
And demanding, and they have issues. What happened to them?
One word, feminism. I would say modern feminism has really thrown a big monkey wrench into this whole relationship between men and women, unfortunately. And you know who's hurting the most? Women are at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Men are hurting a lot because of feminism, and I'm sure we'll get into that.
Right.
But women are, and they're not realizing. The thing is, they're not realizing that they're actually the ones that are hurting themselves. And, you know, they're striving so much to be equal with a man in every way, shape, or form. And they're actually ruining the very things that men used to revere about them and used to cherish about them.
Yeah.
And they're making it not just about equality, but about superiority. I want to be superior to you.
Yeah.
Or I want to be successful at the expense of you.
That is so true.
Someone has, they turn into a zero-sum game, and someone has to be superior. The women think it's them, or they're taught that it needs to be them, you know, with all this women is the future rhetoric. And, you know, who wants to, what kind of a man finds that attractive?
That's
you
right.
know, let me date like someone who wants to be my boss or someone who wants to be better than me. They compete all day long in the workplace. Why do they want to come home to a relationship that a woman is demanding and demeaning like that also?
Do women know that this is, they are the problem for the most part?
That's the thing, most of them do not.
They do not know.
I will probably lose most of my female friends after hearing this interview. And I find, you know, women, not only do they not realize it, they don't want to hear it. When I present this argument to women, you become the black sheep with
yeah.
women. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear at all that they have anything to do with their current state of singledom.
And why is that?
Well, a lot of it is because what they're taught. You know, they're taught from a young age, and in these kind of bullcrap studies like gender studies and women's studies, no offense to someone who went through those programs, but, you know, a lot of it is really just teaching you that the patriarchy is prevalent and it's bad, and, you know, men are the oppressors and you are the oppressed. And so when you just get, you know, taught that, indoctrinated with that, they don't want to hear any other way. They hear this gender wage gap.
That's
they can't
amazing.
See that they're actually the ones perpetuating this animosity between men and women, because that's what it's become. It's not just
sure is.
We became equal to men a long time ago, and now it's turning into this very competitive state of animosity. We're supposed to be friends. We're not supposed to be enemies.
That's right. How else have they hurt the man and woman relationship? Are there other things they've done?
Oh yes. They have stamped out, or tried to stamp out, what beautiful gifts men have to offer that are unique.
Yeah.
The differences between men and women are beautiful, and they were designed that way for a reason.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
And, you know, men by nature, you know, part of what their gifts are is they tend to be protective. They tend to protect those things that they care about and that they love.
That's so true.
Right?
Yes. They are born that way. They're not acting out. It's in their nature.
Totally. It's a beautiful thing. And they also tend to want to provide,
yeah.
give some sort of providership. You know, they kind of want, it makes them feel good intrinsically to take care of and to provide and be kind of the man, you know.
And women have been taught not to let a man provide for you or take care of you.
Right.
It seems they have been made to believe it's like a put down,
mm-hmm.
as though the man thinks he's better than the woman. And that's
right.
not the case at all.
Right, exactly. It's so funny. He feels good doing it. And
yeah.
it's out of love and it's out
yeah.
of care. Another thing is that men, you know, have historically done all the dirty jobs, you know,
yeah.
the jobs that no one talks about, working in the oil rigs.
That's
and,
right.
You know, just risking their lives every day in the military, at war.
Working on cars. I would never
uh-huh.
date a woman that works on a car. You know,
if I even said that, it's a man's job, you know yeah. how much flack I would get? But it's true.
It's a man's job.
You know, yeah.
And then when a man works on a car, they, you know, where is that, a shop or somewhere, mm-hmm. he leaves, he's sweaty.
Covered in oil.
And, right. Who would want a sweaty,
right.
odor-smelling woman to come home?
Right.
You know, you don't want that. You want a woman beautiful, and smell good, and look
yeah.
good.
Yeah, but it wasn't because men wanted to oppress women.
Nothing like that.
It
no.
wasn't because men wanted to have power and control over women. It's because they were trying to shield women from these dirty jobs
yeah.
and from these very, very savory, very risky, and sometimes even really dangerous jobs.
If
and
you
women
ever,
don't understand that.
If you ever catch me with a woman that works at an automobile company or something, I want you to counsel me.
I will.
Yeah, something has gone wrong.
I will come. I'll do an intervention at your house.
You did something. I saw one of your videos, and you said something that was so, so interesting to me.
Okay.
A lot of men are shy.
Yes.
And they're not able to just approach a woman and mm-hmm. talk to her as though she's a human being.
Yeah, they have approach anxiety.
Right. And you gave advice to shy men.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us some of the advice that you give out to shy men.
Yeah, sure.
Describe first what a shy man is.
A shy man is a man who is introverted. You know, he tends to be more introverted, and he just has a problem approaching and talking to women and often with people in general. Like he just, right. he's scared. Yeah. He's scared of them. He's scared of rejection. He's scared of possible embarrassment. And he can't get himself to just make that initial approach.
Right.
Or more than that. And by the way, there's a lot of contributors to why there are more shy men these days. There's, you know, we live in the era of video games and porn and so many different distractions. And it has this effect of having guys have, you know, their social skills have waned.
Yes.
You know, they live in fantasy most of the time. They don't need to develop their social skills. Then when they have to go out in the real world and, God forbid, approach a woman, they're so scared. You know, it's like they're...
That is so true.
They really think of it as a fear, you know, and it gets very scary for them. So I have to kind of tell them, first of all, reprogram their thinking a little bit, their brain, and have them reframe what they think of women as. You know, you see a lot in movies, like a guy will go up and hit on a woman and she doesn't like it and she like slaps him or throws a drink on him. And I have to say, guys, this does not happen in real life.
That's right.
You know, it doesn't happen. And, you know, and I have to get them to think of women as, again, as friendly and not your enemy. And also that, you know, look, it is the initial first step of the mating game.
Yeah.
Men are just required to do that initial effort. And women see that as an initial test of his strength and courage.
Right.
Does he have enough cojones to even come up, you know, and just say hi to me and break the ice? If he doesn't have that, then what kind of a man, how can he handle other stress in life that
That's
are just
true.
Way worse than that?
They
right?
should be willing to do that anyway, because once you face that fear, mm-hmm. it moves you forward in life.
It moves you forward.
Yeah.
And there's so many, when I get my guys to overcome their fear of approaching women,
right.
there's so many other improvements that happen
That's
in their
right.
life as a result, because they start becoming more fearless.
That's right.
And then I have each act of courage kind of builds on the next act. And they start
that
developing
is so
true core confidence and inner strength. And then they look back and they're like, wow, I can't believe I was afraid to approach a woman
that's
at
right.
some point. You know, and then they start, it builds on it, and that's how they build true confidence.
The darndest thing I ever seen is men nowadays, mm-hmm. because it wasn't like that when I was growing up. You know, we didn't have computers, so we had to go out and meet
Right,
them.
You had to, right?
Yeah. They are afraid of women.
Yeah.
It's like they approach them as though they're approaching their mothers.
Yes, that's a great observation.
Yeah.
That's true.
And why is that?
Well, again, it's a lot of it is the lack of social
all that
skills,
stuff that
right?
come with it, yeah.
Another thing, again, I had to blame the woman, but it's, you know, a lot of feminists, they get upset if a guy approaches them or something, and they're trying to, you know, they're so quick to call a man like sexual assault or harassment,
That's right. yeah.
something. So these days, a lot of guys are actually literally afraid that they're going to get sued or
yeah.
have sexual harassment filed on them or something.
That's amazing.
It is amazing and very sad too. I'm like, women, do you understand that like you're never going to have a husband if you are going to tell guys it's wrong to just approach you?
That's right.
You know, you're going to wake up at 50 one day and say, oh my God, why aren't men hitting on me? You asked them not to.
And now a word from our sponsor.
I am so excited. I can't believe it. Finally, the Fall Estate merchandise is here. Look at this beautiful shirt. We have red, white, and black. Comfortable, I like the fit. Really nice t-shirts. And we have mugs. The Fall Estate mug. On the back it says, did you have fun? Did you have fun? A gift. Excellent gifts, both. This is a great way for you to help us. Can you imagine your friends seeing you with this at the office, at the park, in your home? You're gonna love it. Order them now. Go to thefallenstate.tv. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. There are guys that can, as a matter of fact, I know one now mm-hmm. that can get a woman.
Mm-hmm.
He can get truckloads of ladies, right? But he can't keep them.
Yes.
And so if
you
he
say,
you know what, I could get them, but I can't keep them. They'll only come back twice, you know, date
mm-hmm.
twice, they'll have sex and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Or they'll like him, but after a while they won't communicate with him.
Mm-hmm.
What would you say to that guy?
Well, I have an acronym, okay, that I use in my coaching program with guys. So hopefully I can say this, but you know how a lot of times you can say, you tell a guy just like grow some balls.
Yes.
Right? Like just grow some balls, have some balls, use some balls.
That's right.
Right? Now, what does that really mean? Because it's one thing to say grow a pair or grow some balls, but what does that mean in reality for guys? Some guys still don't know what that means.
Right.
And so I actually reverse engineered and thought, okay, what is it about certain guys that they're able to just attract a woman and then totally keep her attraction right. over time and create massive chemistry with them versus guys that just keep falling flat or keep falling in the friend zone?
Yes.
They have balls and they know how to use them.
That is so true.
Right?
Absolutely.
But here's the acronym I made up for balls, okay? Because I have to think a step deeper and be able to teach this to my guys. The B stands for boldness. Because what differentiates a guy who falls into the friend zone or who can't keep a woman versus a guy who doesn't is boldness. He displays yeah. these acts of boldness and courage that, you know, it, at the very core of nature, women are attracted to that.
That's right.
We're attracted to that warrior mentality.
Absolutely.
We could be the strongest woman ever, but we can't take that away.
That's right.
It's how we're wired. That's why we're all attracted to the warrior guy and
yes.
Hercules and everything. So the A stands for action and approach. You've just got to take action. If you're a man of action in life, not a guy who's passive, not a guy who just waits and waits for things to fall in your lap, you're going to get a guy who gets and keeps women's much more often.
Yes.
Keeps women. Winners don't wait. And women intrinsically know that. You know, so a man who's in action, who's doing things, not just with her, but in life, that is sexy.
That is so true. Yeah.
The L stands for leadership, you know, being a man who knows how to lead a woman and doesn't, it isn't, you know, in the age of feminism, a lot of guys take the back seat and think, oh, she wants to wear the pants.
I know.
Not true.
Yeah.
Most women don't. The other L stands for laughter. You know, that's another thing that differentiates guys. You know how to make a woman laugh.
Yes.
Because incorporating laughter, making her laugh and having a good time is just so important. That you don't have to be a good-looking guy. You don't have to be a tall guy or a rich guy. But you can make a woman laugh, you have got her heart. And by the way, this is not, men can be vulnerable with women and that doesn't lose her respect.
What That's is vulnerability myth. With a woman?
There's a myth out there that men can't be vulnerable or they can't share things about themselves that are real. You know, like if I'm having a bad day, you can't share anything like that to a woman. She'll
but
think
women,
of you as weak.
Yeah, she tends to think of a man mm-hmm. as being weak when he does that.
Well, I think that it's important to build the backbone, too. You know, what if you're obviously only talking about that kind of thing and you don't have the backbone to back it up, then yes, then she's going to have a weak picture of you. But if you convey yourself as a strong man, you know, in those other areas that I talked about, and you're bold and you're strong, you definitely can get, you know, leeway to be vulnerable and to also express how you feel about her. Now, again, it's in reason. You know, sometimes guys just go all out expressing how they feel about
her.
Too much, but they didn't create enough respect. So it's important to know how much is, you know, there's a balance there.
So other than the physical, what is the difference between men and women?
As far as attraction goes?
Yeah, whatever yeah. it is.
So basically for women, so men, the first and most important thing is visual.
Right.
But it's not just, this goes back to our survival goals, right? So it's not just about physical. That would be superficial.
But for the man, mm-hmm. when they first see a woman, mm-hmm. it's totally about physical.
Yeah, it's about physical.
They don't care about your brains.
Yes, true.
They don't care if you know how to cook or not.
Right.
They totally see physical.
Yes.
And that's fine, right?
It's fine because yeah. it's survival. So
right.
why it's physical, though, the reason why, it's because men are wired to reproduce.
That's right.
Right? So their goal is reproduction. So signs of reproduction for them, physical signs, are beauty, youth, vitality, you know, whether she's in good health or whether she's obese. Those kinds of things trigger to a man, okay, good reproductive material.
Right.
You know? Whereas for women, the goal is also reproduction, but it's also survival. So when she's looking at a man, the first thing she notices is not his looks. The thing that keeps her attracted is not his looks.
Really?
It is signs of, can this guy protect? Is this guy a good fit mate to reproduce with? But it's not about his looks, it's more about
That's amazing.
Protectorship. Can he protect me and my offspring with him? We're thinking 10 steps ahead, of course. Can he provide a roof over our head? Can he help us survive?
So the average woman is thinking that nowadays when they see a man.
Yes, and it's not thinking. It's actually mostly unconscious. Just like your unconscious reaction to a hot girl who walks by, you're not necessarily thinking reproductive material and all these things.
That's right.
You're just attracted.
That's right.
Women are attracted to signs of protectorship, providership, and reproduction. And that's why we're typically attracted to a guy who displays signs of strength, of success, leadership, boldness, those traits that I talked about, balls. You know, why we're attracted to that goes deeper. It's we're wired to seek that out for survival. And you can call women shallow for seeking those things out, but you can also call men shallow too if you're going to go that route. And it's actually the way we are designed. It's nothing shallow about it. It's actually really smart. And a hot girl to a man is a smart and successful or strong man to a woman. And that's why you can see really unattractive looking guys walking around with gorgeous women. Why can they get that woman?
Yeah,
you know,
that's
it's
true.
Not the same way for guys. It's usually because he's somehow a powerful man, or he's a smart man, he's a funny man, he's a strong man. He's showing those kind of warrior traits.
When you were breaking down the ball situation,
mm-hmm.
it reminded me of Donald Trump.
Yes.
Does that remind you of him?
Absolutely.
He has all those balls.
All the balls.
And then some.
And then some. He has balls bigger than Texas. And you know what? It works, though. I mean,
it does. It totally works.
It works.
Yes.
Nobody wants, you know, you look at the people that he was competing with, low energy, you know, Jeb Bush and all these people.
No balls.
No one's going to, you know, respect that. When you see a comparison,
that's right.
It's more attractive. And especially so if you go in a room full of people, women don't look at the best looking guy in the room. We're trained, you know, we're wired to seek out the loudest or strongest guy in the room, the guy who shows the most balls somehow.
Wow.
You know?
Sex before marriage. Everybody and their mama having sex. And now they're having it at the club, in the bathroom, or wherever they can get it, in the parking lots.
Mm-hmm.
Do you recommend sex before marriage?
My view on that is I am more of a traditionalist, more of a conservative. But I think that nowadays to demand or expect sex after marriage is it's difficult and it's hard. And if you believe that, then I'm all for it.
Right.
But it's just a little bit, it's a lot more unrealistic to actually attain. I do think that you should have sex in a committed relationship, in a space of committed relationship. There should be love present. It should be going somewhere, you know, either towards engagement or marriage or in a serious direction.
Yeah.
And I think sex has gotten way too casual these days.
So
and
should you
look
wait,
at the results of that.
Yeah, should you wait a day or is it okay to do it this first night that you meet the woman?
No, absolutely not. I don't think
wait?
So.
You should wait until you feel love for the person?
I think that you should wait until you're in a committed relationship. If you rush too soon, you know, most guys, if they're let loose on that, they would want to have sex on the first date.
That's right.
Or the second date, you know?
That's right.
But then they lose interest afterwards.
Absolutely.
Because that was it. Yeah.
That's right, because the excitement is gone.
Yeah.
You know, the sexual excitement is mm-hmm. gone. Now they're looking for a new girl to get the same feeling back again.
Exactly. Whereas women, we're wired differently. We're wired toward monogamy. So when we have sex with a man, we have oxytocin that releases a chemical that makes us want to bond to that man.
Yeah.
But for men, they want to, like, get the heck out of the bed. If they just
that's
slept
right.
with it, right?
Once
it's
they
so
finish,
funny.
Don't touch me, don't talk to me,
right.
I don't want to hug up.
Yeah.
Why are you still here?
Yeah, like get
and
get a cab
like,
already.
Love and, oh, hold me.
Yeah.
No more holding.
Exactly. And that's another kind of feminist lie that women, you can just be just as promiscuous as men, go out and like, you know, get your sex on and you can have sex like a man. You can't. Nature says so. You know, we have that oxytocin that releases and we're not. So women end up being miserable.
Yeah.
And what's happened as a result, have men have gotten the free pass to just like do whatever. And, you know, that's really, it's hurting relationships, it's hurting romance, it's hurting marriages.
Plus men don't, the average man, some do, but most don't want a woman that has slept with a lot of different men anyway.
Right.
They don't see that woman as a wife and a mother to mm-hmm. their children. There's an organization or a movement called MGTOW.
MGTOW?
You heard of that?
Yes.
Men going their own way. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that group? Or men who are doing that?
It's a hard thing to admit, but it's understandable why they would choose to go their own way. And that's what's scary, is there's actually a rational reason why they would do that. Mm-hmm. If you're being told all your life that you are bad and wrong just for being a man, and that you have toxic masculinity for being a man, and that, you know, women, there's this famous feminist expression that, you know, a woman needs a man just like a fish needs a bicycle, and that men are basically useless, and that men are terrible, and that, you know, women are superior. How would you feel? I mean, you know, you're not going to feel that attracted to a woman or care to be loving towards her or romantic towards her. So this men going their own way movement is a reaction to that. I really think it's a rational reaction to that. Men are finally like, hey, we've given you all you want. You know, you are equal in every way, and then you're still shaming us.
Yeah.
So for a lot of the men, it's, and a lot of them have gotten screwed over in terrible relationships and divorces, and gotten their kids taken away from them. So it's an understandable response. Now, I do think there's another option, though. There's a third route. I don't think they need to just hang up the shingle on women and quit women altogether. That's not being part of the solution. There's a lot of women out there that still are more traditional women, that they are good women. They love men. They respect men. They appreciate the differences between men. And they're out there. You know, it's not right to put all women in this one basket.
I think rather than going so far crazy on this thing, mm-hmm. I think men need to look at their weakness and overcome their weakness and start dealing with women in the way that a man should deal with a woman.
Right.
Then they wouldn't end up in these bad situations.
Exactly.
Rather than running away from it.
Exactly. And, you know, that's why I created this BALLS program. Sorry to keep saying, but, you know, it's because a lot of guys think this, they buy into this myth that, oh, well, nice guys finish last, and I have to be this jerk in order to attract women. I can't be nice because every time I'm nice, I'm screwed over. That's not true. It's not true either. You know, again, what you said, a lot of times they might just not be understanding certain, you know, elements about women, that you can be nice, you should be nice. Any sane woman wants a nice guy, but also backed up with boldness and balls and, you know, doing certain masculine things that women respect.
The niceness that you're speaking of is, because niceness is a weakness, but the one you're talking about is not the weak one.
Kindness.
Be a man, but, right.
Any sane woman wants a man who's a gentleman and who's a kind man, who's a loving man, who's a good man.
Yeah.
You know, we want a good man, but one who also we respect. A lot of guys who fall into that too nice category, what they call the beta guy, what they do incorrectly is they rely only on their niceness. And in fact, they can be a bit manipulative deep down when I really press them on it. They're using niceness as like their trump card. They're niceness as a technique because they think that's going to win women over. And that's all they got. That's the only card they have in their deck. They're not making her laugh. They're not having fun. They don't know how to be bold. They don't know how to flirt. So yeah, of course that's going to be conveyed as boring. And if they're not enforcing their boundaries at all, then they're allowing themselves just to get walked over by women.
In a marriage. Oh, let me ask, what is love?
What is love?
What is love?
I think love is mutual respect and mutual, it's a decision. I mean, first and foremost, it's a feeling. You know, it's a feeling that you are attracted to this person and that you feel passion for this person and care.
Is that a faint love? I mean, that's the thing that brings you together, but it doesn't last.
Yeah, that's where, you know, it starts with a feeling and then it lasts with a decision.
Okay.
It's a commitment. It's a decision to commit to each other and stay in love. Even when you don't feel love sometimes or some days, or for some couples, some months will go by where they don't feel that feeling of love, but the decision that you love, that you respect and care and love this person so much that you're going to be together, you're going to stay together. And love takes work. It also, by the way, you can recreate those feelings of love and that honeymoon feeling of passion. You can create that over time. A lot of people have this myth that it goes away after a couple years. It doesn't have to go away.
I noticed that a lot of men are spending money on women that they're dating.
Mm-hmm.
And they sometimes allow the woman to come live with them, or they go live with her.
Mm-hmm.
They buy cars and clothes for the woman and take her on trips. Personally, I think that's the wrong thing to do because it's not your wife.
Yeah.
And then you're setting the woman up to use you.
Right.
Because she's learning about you based on material things and not who you really are.
Right.
And so I think that the best you should do for a woman while dating is buy a nice little dinner, you know, at McDonald's or Jack in the Box or or maybe go to a movie. Do you think men should be spending money on women prior to marriage?
I feel the same way about, do I think a woman should be kind of giving up all her goods prior to marriage?
No, right.
No, I don't think so. I think there are certain perks that happen in the marriage or in a space of commitment. And I think that a man should do things that are, you know, a fit to his lifestyle.
Right.
If he normally goes out to nice dinners or travels or something, then it would feel fitting to take her along with him.
Really? And should he pay for it?
I think that, you know, it depends on the income differential, but that's part of the risk in love. You know, that's part of the risk that happens before a committed relationship or marriage. You both are kind of risking. You're risking emotions. You're risking and investing money. You know, you're risking investing things, and she's risking and investing her body, and so is he.
Oh, Lord.
So you can't get a refund for the sex, you know, if you break up. And that's why I think you should reserve some things, too, for marriage, so that you don't get bitter afterwards and say, well, I did all this with the expectation that you were not going to dump me. Because, again, what's the perk in marriage, then, if you're doing everything that you would normally do as a married couple but without marriage?
I had an expert, a woman, tell me that when a man meets a woman and when they kiss for the very first time, she recommended they don't even kiss because to a woman, that first kiss is a marriage. To the man, it's just sex. But to the woman, it means everything. It's like a marriage. She's meeting her husband. Do you see is that possible?
Yes, I do. I think that women put a lot more weight on the first kiss than a man probably does.
Yeah, because to a man, the first kiss is just working her way to the bedroom. There's nothing more.
This is true. All
right, but
this
to a woman, it's working her way to the marriage, the church, or wherever they get married.
Yeah, well, women and men also perceive the first date differently, too. We have different expectations. We're hoping on every day, this is going to be the man of my dreams, and we're evaluating him from like a 10 years later perspective.
Wow. That's not what he's thinking.
Is he going to be a good father? Is he going to be a good husband? I mean, we're thinking all those things.
And he's thinking, I can't wait for the second date, because I know I'm going to get this.
Yes, exactly.
So, wow.
Yeah, we do. I don't think that the first kiss means like marriage to a woman necessarily, but we definitely put more weight on it than a guy does.
Amazing.
And a guy should know that, too. He should give her a knockout first kiss.
That's right. In a marriage, there is an order where the man is the head of his wife. That's not happening today, and as a result, a lot of marriages are not lasting because the order is broken. Do you agree with that?
I do agree with that. I believe that, why do we mess with something that's not broken? I mean, I think that the man is like the captain and a woman is the co-captain.
Yes.
You know, they're both important.
Right.
They're both valuable. They're both equal in value, but they just have slightly different roles. And there's nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with it.
It works like yin and yang. It's harmonious.
Right.
And a man should be the head of the house. I think it's a best role. The woman is like the supportive role. But, you know, as long as that's not abused, as that power is not abused, then it works perfectly, I think.
And he's not the head of the house. He's head of his wife.
Yeah.
His wife.
Right.
I got to ask you this. What do you think about a man that, quote unquote, is a stay-home mother, a mom, or whatever he calls himself?
You know,
can you get any weaker than that?
I have this initial visceral reaction for some reason when I think of that. And I don't know why. And I know it's probably my own bias.
Because it's
wrong. It is kind of wrong.
Being a woman.
There's the respect issue, right? Yeah. I can't imagine coming home every day from working all day and then I see my man taking care of the kids.
Yeah.
I don't see it. I don't feel it. And I guarantee if a woman's honest, every woman will say the same thing. And I think it's just, even how attraction works, we want to respect a man, we want to admire him, we want to look up to him.
Yes.
So how is that going to work when we're coming home and we're seeing him do these, you know, traditionally feminine duties? So why,
so
I don't know why we want
to
mess with the
say,
word.
You're able to say all these things on your channel?
Yes.
Masturbation channel?
I lose a little bit of female fans,
but
there's women that think how I think and they are coming out of the woodwork. And my goal is to be kind of a beacon for them and have the women all over the world that think this way, that are afraid to say it, but, you know, but start aligning with this group so that they can, you know, also get more men too, you know, men who think this way.
Tell the folks how to get your books to your site, all the stuff, how to get in contact with you.
Well, I have a book being published this summer along with a podcast calling Making Love Great Again. And that's going to be available on my website at DeAnnaLorraine.com.
Okay.
So go to my website at DeAnnaLorraine.com, and also my YouTube channel is Deanna Lorraine. I have a lot of videos that I talk about these kinds of issues.
So my final question.
Yes.
Did you have fun?
I had a blast. Because I'm talking about all things that I'm so passionate about.
Yes.
So I had a great time. Did you have a good time?
I had a good time.
Okay.
Fallen State.
The African Student Union at UCLA released a list of demands in response to a few incidents on campus.
The student body president, there was a picture released with him throwing up a gang sign, and it triggered many students who saw that this white man, privileged white man, throwing up a blood gang sign. Because for many people, they have family members who've been a part of that gang. And so many students were very uncomfortable at the picture.
That's amazing. Thanks for watching The Fallen State. We need your continued support. Donate to my nonprofit here. Subscribe and like the videos here. And tell everybody and their mama about the show.